last few years in pension tax legislation, which is where I specialise, there's an awful lot going on. Cast our mind back to 2015 with the introduction of pension freedoms. I would almost say that at that point, she's been sexy. I'm sure that's not two words you would ever thought you'd hear in the one sentence, pension and sexy. Certainly with pension freedoms, it opened up opportunities for people to re-engage with pensions. And I'm not one for using analogies, but it's a bit like Leicester City Football Club winning the Premiership. Contrary to what everyone thought, it was an eye-opening experience. It was great for the football, just due to the fact that the usual teams didn't win it. But as you recall, the then manager, Claudio Ranieri, known as the Tinkerman, and that's where we are now with pension tax legislation in particular. Philip Hammond, who just seems to want to tinker with the legislation, the obvious one being a reduction in the money purchase annual allowance from 10,000 to 4,000. Didn't seem to be any real reason for doing that, other than thought we would do something, thought we would tinker a little bit with it. My concern is that, unlike Ranieri, who was sacked and replaced by Isaac Craig Shakespeare, I didn't know very much about football, but he was replaced. My concern is that we might have Philip Hammond do something quite drastic with pensions, and that would be to abolish tax relief for higher rate individuals and additionally. That's only a personal view. I think that's probably in the pipeline, given the general state of country's economy and the fact that things it has tried to do to raise money, such as now for self-employed people, has all gone on the back burner. So I think with respect to pensions, it's an easy low-lying fruit to grab that pension tax. So given that there's not been very much happening, what I did was we just looked at the sort of questions that we get into the TSU, and thought that one of the areas that we do get an awful lot of questions on is benefit crystallisation. So what I thought we'd do to do is just go back to first principles about pension simplification, look at BCEs, how they work, how legislation is around them, and finish up by looking at BCEs at age 75. If you've got any questions, I'm going through this session, by all means, stop me and ask. The other thing to point out is that there is what's called a TED Talk on this very subject. And indeed, a lot of the examples that are on the slides are also in the TED Talk, which there is a number of them available at the reception area. So, first of all, what we want to do is look at the BCEs, benefit crystallisation rents, what they actually are, and then look at the main BCEs that occur when people come to take their benefits. And then we'll introduce some of the detail behind the legislation and do that by means of some case studies. And then, as I said, finish up by looking at the area of BCEs, which again is an area that we get a lot of questions on. So, what is a BCE? Well, it's basically a test that is done and someone comes to take the benefits. More often than not, when they're crystallising their funds to take an income and a PCOS. There are 13 BCEs, 1 through to 9, 5 to 5D. 5A and 5B, ones that apply to 5. 5C and 5E were the ones that were introduced back in 2015 to catch the tax advantages of pension freedom and passing on wealth through the generations. There are what you might call non-benefit triggers or BCEs, and as I said, some of those are the 5, the 5A and the 5B, but equally transferring from a registered pension scheme to PROPS, it's also a BCE8, and also there's a BCE3, which applies in the case of someone who has income from the pension in the form of a pension, and if that income is increased beyond what is called a prescribed level, then another BCE occurs, and that individual will use up the amount of their lifetime allowance. The BCEs themselves only cash old authorised payments. If payment from the pension scheme is not one of these BCEs, it's an unauthorised payment. If it's an unauthorised payment, then it is subject to the unauthorised payment charges, potentially at 55% seems in Angola? Is it me that is doing it, or is it just... I shall stand here, if that makes it any easier. Okay. I was deliberately trying to get away from there and stand in the middle of it rather than hide behind the lectern. But anyway, so the most common VCEs are VCE1, where an individual is putting their benefits into the drawdown, so designating the fund to draw down to provide an income. A VCE2, which is a scheme pension, which I alluded to earlier, and a scheme pension is the only way you can have a pension from a final salary scheme, a DB scheme. You can have them BCE2 related to taking a scheme pension from a money purchase arrangement, but it is very much a niche market and there's very few providers still in that market offering that. BCE4, the most common ones probably in the past, which was an annuity, and then taking a relevant lump sum, a BCE6, of which a PCLS falls into that category, along with an uncrystallised fund pension lump sum. The BC, when someone comes to take the benefits, such as through drawdown and a PCLS, then BCE6 occurs first. Does anyone want to volunteer why that would be the case? Indeed, yeah. If the BCE6 occurred second, then the person crystallising the fund, say, beyond their lifetime allowance, would have fully used up their lifetime allowance by taking, say, the drawdown fund, and therefore would have nothing left to be able to take the PCLS. And that's more important where an individual has protected cash in the form of scheme-specific lump sum protection or a higher cash amount where they've got primary protection. Okay, so the BCE6 occurs first, and then the BCE1 thereafter. So that's the basic principles of it. I really don't need to say very much more, but what we'll do is we'll look at some examples just to show you how very quickly the legislation becomes quite complicated. So just looking at some case studies, Alexis crystallised $625,000 of her SIP back in 2016, took the maximum PCLS, which is $156,000, and then put the rest of it into drawdown of $460,000. So with a BCE6, a PCLS, and a BCE1, total amount crystallised, $625,000. She has fixed protection, 2016, which gives her a personal lifetime allowance of $1.25 million. So she's used up 50% of her lifetime allowance. Dead simple. Okay. What if Alexis decides at a later date to take some of that money that she designated into drawdown and purchase an annuity? Well, bear in mind that what she designated to drawdown has already been tested against her lifetime allowance. So there's an allowance made for the fact that that money, or some of that money, has already been tested. Okay. So what we have here in this scenario, step two, is Alexis decides this year to take $300,000 from her drawdown fund and purchase an annuity with that. Okay. Because she hasn't taken any income from her drawdown pot, it's grown in value from $468,000 to $500,000. So what we need to do is apportion what growth is in there against what she's purchasing within the annuity, and then allocate that growth proportionately to her lifetime allowance. So the way that's done is quite simple. Take the $300,000 annuity that she's purchasing, divide it by the value of the fund, the drawdown fund, and that comes out as a figure of £281,250. So in other words, she's used up another £18,750 of her lifetime allowance. That divided by $1.25 million means that Alexis has used the full 1.5% of her lifetime allowance. Okay, quite happy with that. Now, what we're doing here is just looking at relatively straightforward examples. And in fact, if you look at what's called a pension tax manual, which is HMRC's guidance on pension tax legislation, it often refers to percentages, okay, of how much of the lifetime allowance an individual has used up. However, if you go back to the primary legislation, the Finance Act, it talks about monetary amounts and rebasing those monetary amounts to reflect the change in lifetime allowance over the years. And if you can cast your minds back to the halcyon days of
the standard lifetime allowance increasing, that was relatively straightforward because it was always going up. With George Osborne, we've gone the opposite way, and because the standard lifetime allowance has been reducing, there's been instances where there's been quirks in the legislation that meant sometimes people have been penalised for a reduction in the lifetime allowance in terms of being able to take maximum benefits. Okay? But in most instances, percentages are fine. But we have to rebase them if we look at the legislation. And the way that's done is we look at the previous BCEs, take what was crystallised and multiply that by an adjustment factor. Okay? And the adjustment factor, the formula, is this thing called CSLA over PSLA. And CSLA is the current standard lifetime allowance, the SBCE. However, that number is replaced by a particular personal lifetime allowance if that individual has fixed or individual protection. Okay. So instead of using the standard lifetime allowance, you're using the personal lifetime allowance for that CSLA. Okay. PSLA, the denominator, is again standard lifetime allowance in the legislation, and it would be the standard lifetime allowance that would apply at the time of the previous BCE. But again, if the individual has fixed protection, so on, certain forms of protection, then the PSLA is replaced by their own personal lifetime allowance plan. And it's important to know that because even if they subsequently lose it, you need to know what their personal lifetime allowance was at the time of that previous BCE. But as I said a moment ago, in most instances that you're dealing with clients, the vast majority of people, it's a simple process of just looking at percentages. But there are odd occasions where you really need to go back to that first principle of looking at the formula and revaluing previous BCEs. So just by way of taking our exit scenario to the next stage, and she's obviously crystallised funds of $625,000 in the past, moved some money into an annuity, and now what she wants to do is crystallise the remainder of her SIP fund, which is worth $800,000. Okay. She'll take the maximum PCLS, BCE6, and also designate the remaining fund into drawdown. So a permitted maximum, which is 25% of what you're crystallising, subject to the limit of what you've got left of your lifetime allowance. And because Alexis has crystallised beyond her 50% of her lifetime allowance, she can't get the full PCLS, if you think, because she's used up, within creating the annuity, some of her lifetime allowance. So her maximum, permitted maximum now, is $151,000, okay? So 25% of $606,000. We have revalued her previous BCEs on this slide, but it's a bit immaterial because at this point, Alexis has got fixed protection with a personal lifetime allowance of 1.25. So it just means that that revaluation is always 1.25 divided by 1.25. Okay. But in the case of someone with no form of protection, we'd be having to look at what the previous lifetime allowances were at that previous BCE. Okay. So she takes $156,000, she designates the remainder to drawdown, but because she's exceeding her lifetime allowance, then there's a lifetime allowance charge for her to pay. Okay. And that would be 25% of $193,000. She's gone beyond her personal lifetime allowance. So what she does is she pays that tax, or indeed the scheme administrator pays it, and that leaves her with a net drawdown fund of $600,000. Now, when Alexis comes to take any income from that drawdown fund, she'll pay tax at her marginal rate. And if, like me, I'm a visual person, we'll just sort of quickly look at that in the context of what she's actually done. So she crystallised $625,000 capital with a lifetime allowance of $1.25 million. She then took an additional use of the lifetime allowance by moving $300,000 from her drawdown fund into her annuity. And then finally, she crystallised the remainder of the fund up to $1.25 million, but she suffered that charge of £101,000. Okay. Everybody happy with that? I mentioned previously about being aware of what someone's personal lifetime allowance was in the past. more importantly, where they lose their protection for some reason. And in this scenario, we have a row who applied for fixed protection in 2012, giving him a personal lifetime allowance of 1.8 million. In June 2012, he crystallised 900,000, so he used up 50% of his personal lifetime allowance. However, unfortunately for Rao, he paid a contribution into his SIP in 2013. A contribution into a SIP is what's called benefit accrual, and that results in the loss of the protection. But fortunately for Rao, he was able to apply for fixed protection in 2014. And then he's now wanting to crystallise the remainder of his fund of 600,000. So what we do is we look at those previous BCEs and we revalue them using that formula CSLA over PSLA. Okay? And if you remember, where someone has fixed protection, we replace those standard lifetime allowance with their personal lifetime allowance numbers. So in the case of Royal, what we're looking at is his current personal lifetime allowance is 1.5 million. However, when he crystallised those benefits back in 2012, his personal lifetime allowance, because of fixed protection, was 1.8 million. Okay? It's important when you're sitting down with clients to know what they've done in terms of the protection. Otherwise, you get that calculation wrong. So in this case, 1.5 divided by 1.8 multiplied by 900,000 works out at 750,000. 750,000 over his current personal lifetime allowance of 1.5 million is still 50%. Okay? But if you didn't know that he had fixed protection in 2012, then you would have been dividing that 1.5 by 1.5, and that would have given you 900,000 divided by 1.5, therefore not 50%. 60%. Okay, so current BCE is going to use up 600,000 from his uncrystallised fund. 600,000 over 1.25 is a further 40%. So that means that Royal is left with 10% of the lifetime allowance that he has, and the fixed protection of 1.5. So he's still got headroom of 150,000 to work with. Again, the two pictures. Use 900,000 in the first BCE, 1.5 used up with the second BCE, which is his total in monetary terms, in capital terms, of what his lifetime allowance currently is, i.e. 1.5 million. But because of that revaluation, he's still got that 10% to work with. So, again, relatively straightforward, but we know from personal experience that pension tax legislation really never is. And that one of the complications comes about where someone has primary protection, and the primary protection where they've taken benefits pre and post the 6th of April 2014. Okay? Because at that point, the revaluation of the previous BCE before April 2014, the formula changes again. CSLA is replaced by a flat figure of 1.5, and then PSLA, or previous standard lifetime allowance at that BCE. Okay? And the 1.5 will remain in existence until the standard lifetime allowance is greater than that. And the chances of that happening, whilst we're still around speaking to clients, is probably pretty slim. So again, just to put a little bit of meat on the bones, we'll look at another case study, Roberto. He holds primary protection. He's got an enhancement factor of 0.4, so that means he can crystallise 1.8 million times 1.4. So he's crystallised in the past 1.6 million and 600,000, and he now wants to take the remainder of his pension, which is £500,000. Okay. So we have to revalue those BCEs. So as said, 1.8 times 1.4. The 1.6 is revalued by taking the 1.5 million because that BCE occurred before April 2014 and dividing that by the standard lifetime allowance that was applicable then, which is 1.6. And then the 600,000 that he crystallised in 2015, we're looking just at the default formula there of the standard lifetime allowance at the moment, which is £1 million, divided by the standard lifetime allowance that was available back in 2015, which was 1.25 million. Okay. So what we have is a figure of 2.52 million minus 1.5, which is the revalued numbers from 2007, and then the revalued figure back to 2015. So what we have headroom-wise is he's still got £540,000 to work with. So by taking the £500,000 today, he's still within his lifetime allowance and therefore would not have any LTA charge to pay. So in capital terms, 1.6 million original crystallisation, then took another 600,000 and then the 500,000. And as you can see, that total figure is greater than 2.52 million of his personal lifetime allowance, and that is achieved simply by that revaluation process. So in the revaluation process, we're getting to 2.48 million. Silence. Stopped. So it is that simple. Now the next area that we get a lot of questions on is tests at age 75, how do they work? What's the purpose of them? So, potentially three BCEs at age 75. We have a BCE5, where someone is in a final salary scheme, defined benefit scheme, and they haven't yet taken their benefits. There is nothing in the legislation that requires an individual to take their benefits at age 75. Just probably find that within the scheme rules, they will have to take benefits at 75. But in theory, they can take them beyond that date, or rather that age. BCE5A, which is testing the funds that have previously been crystallised into a money purchase arrangement and then to drawdown. And then 5B was introduced to pick up where funds are not crystallised in the money purchase arrangement. BCE5 and 5B are relatively straightforward. You're looking at the effective value, capital value of the fund, and then testing that against the individual's lifetime allowance. BCE5A, which is the one that tends to cause most confusion, is because if you think of the purchase of the annuity by Alexis, the BCE5A is testing funds that have already been designated to drawdown. So they've been tested once, and to avoid that double counting or that potential double charge, there's an allowance made for what was originally designated into drawdown. So the end result is that with a BCE5A, all you're doing is testing the growth on the fund. Okay? And you ignore any income that the individual has taken previously. So it means that if you have clients where they have growth on the fund and they've got nothing left of their lifetime allowance, for instance, because of flexi access drawdown, in a few years leading up to retirement, it might be prudent to strip some income out of the fund to get it back down to what the level was of the original designation, okay? Rather than leaving it and suffering a lifetime allowance charge on that growth and then a subsequent income tax charge on taking the income from it. Another case study, Nigella is coming up to her 75th birthday. She previously crystallised funds up to her lifetime allowance when it was 1.8 million, taking the maximum PCLS of 450,000 and designating 1.35 million into drawdown. She's got other sources of income, so she hasn't actually taken any income from her drawdown pot, and it's now grown to 1.6 million. In addition, she's also got £200,000 in uncrystallised funds. So she's coming up to her 75th birthday. Nigella's got a couple of options. What she could do is take the excess now, so crystallise that 200,000, and she's got two choices there. One would be to take what's called a lifetime allowance excess lump sum, and the tax charge is 55% there. So 200,000, 55% tax charge paid by the scheme administrator, therefore Nigella receives in her bank account £90,000. The other option for her, and the first one should say is only available up until 75th birthday, so when she hits her 75th birthday, she can't take that lifetime allowance excess lump sum. The other option for her is to do what's called a retained amount, where she retains the excess in her fund, her drawdown fund, and in that instance, the tax charge is at 25%. The thing is that once she takes an income from that excess pot, she will pay tax at her marginal rate. Okay? Now, most providers don't operate separate pots for a fund that's crystallised up to the lifetime allowance and the fund that is over the lifetime allowance, but to try and explain it, if we imagine that that's the case, so the pot of 150,000, when she comes to take income from that, if she's paying tax at 40%, then the 40% income tax rate plus the 25% tax charge up front equates to 55% anyway. So in effect, it's neutral. The difference today is, of course, that we're now looking at standard lifetime allowance of £1 million, and people might not be higher rate taxpayers. So leveraging the tax advantage, it would imply that you would want to leave it in the pension fund because the overall tax charge would be less. Because the other thing that this ignores, and which a number of advisors forget about, is if Nigella takes the lifetime allowance excess lump sum and sticks it in the bank, then potentially it is also subject to IHT at a further 40%. So leveraging the tax advantage, to me, would seem to imply, certainly nowadays, leave it in the fund and it'll be better off tax-wise. If Nigella decided not to do anything, she got to 75th birthday, then two BCEs occur. BCE 5A, which is testing the growth on the fund. So if you can remember from previous slide, she originally designated 1.35 million into a fund. It's now worth 1.6 million because she's not taking any income. So there's £250,000 of growth. Because it's called a retained amount, as I alluded to earlier, the tax charge there is 25%. So she pays £62,500 in tax on that. Again, it's a case of the member themselves, or Nigella, and the scheme administrator being jointly and severally liable for that tax charge. So invariably, it's the scheme administrator that pays the tax charge. So £62,500, but she's also still got this £200,000 of uncrystallised fund, so she'll pay a further tax charge at 25% on that. So her total tax charge at age 75 is £112,500. Almost at exactly that time, saving me potentially 2 minutes. Okay. So what we did was we looked at the common BCEs, how the benefit crystallisation events work, what they are, and we looked at taking benefits in some of the scenarios, and also just some of the complexity that quickly builds with clients where they have any form of protection. If your clients don't have any form of protection, then using the percentage method would suffice, but bear in mind that they might not have any form of protection at the moment, but they could have had some form in the past. And then we looked at the age 75 tests. Any questions? Was it too technical? The last presentation wasn't technical, so it was good. So I thought I would try and dull your senses so that you enjoy the coffee that's coming next.
Thanks, Ian.
Okay.
Thanks, thank you very much.